Welcome to History at Home, a new series sponsored by the Minnesota Historical Society. I'm Virginia Wright-Peterson, author of The Women of Mayo Clinic, The Founding Generation. And tonight, we're here to celebrate the publication of a new book, A Woman's War II, Women at Work During World War II. I'm here tonight with Harper. Sneak in there, all right. Yes, named after the author. And we're taking a few tips from Jimmy Fallon, who is doing his show from home, and he has some assistance with some great signs too. So I'm also here with my daughter, Christina, who is a nurse with the public health department. So if you're wondering why we are all together, it is because we help support Chris and her job, and she and the public health staff of Olmsted County try to help us mitigate this difficult pandemic situation. And then Harper and I spend some of our time doing second grade math, and she helps me with my day job on the administrative team at the University of Minnesota Rochester. Yes, for those of you that didn't know, there is a campus of the University of Minnesota in Rochester where we have the privilege of educating healthcare providers of tomorrow. I'd also like to do a little bit of a shout out as we get going to a couple of younger listeners I think might be watching. Sammy in Le Sueur is an aspiring writer, and I believe Cora might be watching in Minneapolis with her father, Andrew. These young girls, including Harper, and young boys, I also have a grandson, Keith, I'm hoping that these stories will be inspirational for them as we look at the courage and aspiration, the obstacles that these people overcame, as well as we all know, history can also highlight for us some of the mistakes we've made in the past, and perhaps these younger people can help us avoid those in the future. I'd also like to thank the Minnesota Historical Society Press for publishing both of these books, and my editor, Shannon Pennefeather, who has just been absolutely marvelous, a miracle worker, and among many other talents, she loves helping fix my footnotes. So a big thank you to her. The book is also made possible by the voters, you, of Minnesota, through a grant from the Southeastern Minnesota Arts Council. And thanks to the legislative appropriation from the Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund. So all kinds of things go into making this book possible. Also, as we get started, I really wasn't planning on launching this book from my living room, but here we are. I guess that has some advantages and some disadvantages. In terms of advantages, maybe a lot more people can participate. There are only about 8 that fit in my living room. And maybe we're a little more comfortable. I'm wearing my slippers and some handmade socks by my good friend Carol, who's spending some of her stay-at-home time doing things like knitting for us and making some really awesome homemade masks here. But I do, in all seriousness, just want to recognize it. I just couldn't go on sort of with this celebration or acknowledgement without talking just a minute about the pandemic, which in Minnesota alone has cost 319 lives as of today. And tonight, while we're gathering, I'm painfully aware of the fact that 119 people are in ICUs fighting for their lives. And I just want to keep that in mind as well as all of the frontline workers, people like my daughter in public health, who are working so hard along with the healthcare workers on the front lines, the first responders, the people in the grocery stores, people especially today that we're thinking about working in meat processing plants, grocery stores, delivering all of the things that we need to our homes. This is a real event that will be one of those things that people read about in the future in history books. I'm assuming that most of the people viewing tonight like reading history, and we've read a lot about events like this, including the 1918 the 1918 pandemic. And last week's Minnesota Historical Society live event featured another author, Kurt Brown, who's talked a lot about the year 1918 in Minnesota, which was afflicted by the flu, a fire, and war all at one time in the state. So some people will be reading about what we are experiencing right now. So our game plan for tonight is I'm going to talk for 20 or 30 minutes, giving you some of the expert excerpts and stories from A Woman's War II, and with Harper's help throughout the way. And then we're going to open it up for questions. And I'm really looking forward to some of the things that you observe, comment, and have to say. In the meantime, while you're watching, I also want to point out that if you want to purchase the book, I highly encourage you to purchase it from your independent bookseller, your favorite independent bookseller. If you don't have an independent bookseller, I have one in mind for you, and that's the Drury Lane bookseller up on the shores of Lake Superior. They had invited me to do a reading up there this weekend, which of course can't happen. So Gwen at Drury Lane is standing by. If you go to their website, you'll be able to purchase copies of the books. And we have arranged, normally at a book launch, you'd be able to get signed copies. Gwen will help get books to me that I can sign for you. So why another book on World War II? Why did I write a book on World War II? It was a lot of work. But what happened was, as I was finishing the book on Mayo Clinic, The Women of Mayo Clinic, that book ends in 1943. And I was starting to hear the stories of some women, Julia Herrick, who was a biophysicist at Mayo Clinic at that time and was loaned to the War Department to go to Fort Monmouth and work with the Army Signal Corps on radar research. It just really piqued my interest. And her story led to the story of Ruth Erickson, that led to another story. The next thing you knew, I had a lot of stories. This book is 245 pages long, but it could have been thousands and thousands of pages long. I just kept finding stories, and I was amazed that all of these women were doing these things here in Minnesota. I had thought a lot of the war efforts were somewhat like Rosie the Riveter. I was familiar with her. But I thought a lot of it happened on the coasts, not necessarily in Minnesota. And I was surprised to find that a lot of efforts, especially the supply lines, were concentrated in the center part of the country. And Minnesota had a very unique and important role in providing ammunition, food, ships, planes, a few things that we'll be talking about soon. And what interested me is that I didn't hear about much of this when I was taking history classes, which was a little while ago, but women's history isn't really, women's stories aren't portrayed in our typical histories of events to the same extent that men's are. And when women's perspectives are added, it's just a richer, more complete, kind of comprehensive look at what happened. So I'm excited to share these stories for you using Women of Minnesota as kind of a case study for what was going on throughout this entire nation during World War II. One of the things that surprised me, in addition to just the sheer numbers of the stories, were the fact that women were in every branch of the military. This includes the Marines and the Coast Guard. They served in so many different roles in the military and outside of it, but as cryptologists, journalists, pilots, riveters, mechanics, nurses, entertainers, and even spies. But they did this work, again, I guess I would have gone into it assuming, I did go into it assuming, a lot of it, they were just in the United States, in Minnesota, or maybe other parts of the country. But what was surprising to me is that women were overseas in relatively large numbers as well. Women from Minnesota were at the Battle of Britain, at the fall and liberation of France, Operation Torch in North Africa. They were there with General Eisenhower. They were at the reoccupation of the Aleutian Islands in Alaska. They were at D-Day, Battle of the Bulge, the liberation of Dachau concentration camp, the reclamation of the Philippines and New Guinea, the Manhattan Project, and two women that I know of were even in Japan when the atomic bombs were dropped. It crosses all races, classes, and geographic areas of the state. So that is kind of what motivated me to go ahead and write this book. Then I was confronted when I had all of these stories and continued to collect all of these stories to figure out how to organize it. And at first I really resisted starting the book with Pearl Harbor because it seems like all books about World War II start with Pearl Harbor. But in the end I decided there aren't any books that I know of that start with a narrative about Pearl Harbor written by a woman from a woman's point of view. So I did decide to go ahead, and the book is basically written in chronological order, a retelling of the war, including the stories of these women from Minnesota. So I'd like to read just an excerpt from the first pages. Ruth Erickson was 4,000 miles from her hometown of Virginia, Minnesota, when fighter planes began bombing the naval base where she was stationed. That Sunday morning, still in her house coat and curlers, she was having a quiet breakfast in the dining room with three other nurses. She had plans to picnic with friends later in the day on the other side of the island. While she and the nurses were talking, they heard a deep hum of planes coming in close and assumed pilots were doing extra reserve flying. When they started to hear noise that sounded like shooting, Ruth went into the corridor to look out a window. She saw a plane with a large rising sun insignia fly by low. So low that if Ruth had known the pilot, she could have recognized him through his goggles and called him by name. Fortunately, he passed by, presumably looking for a more significant target. A few moments later, shortly after 8 a.m. on December 7, 1941, the attack on Pearl Harbor began. Ruth ran to her room, pulling out her pin curls along the way. Phones began ringing. And the chief nurse yelled, "Girls, get in your uniforms at once. This is the real thing." After quickly dressing, Ruth dashed across the street through a shower of shrapnel. Her sense of purpose carried her as far as the screened porch outside the administrative section of the Navy hospital. Once she stopped, she froze, unable to move until an inner voice told her to get going. She ran to the orthopedic dressing room, found it locked. She shouted to a corpsman to get the keys. It seemed to take him forever to open the door. By then, several nurses had arrived, and they began to prepare for possible casualties. Little did they know, 2,403 servicemen would die, and 1,143 would be injured that day. The first casualty came in at 8:25 a.m. Then I described a little bit about Ruth Erickson, who was born in the town of Virginia in northern Minnesota in what we refer to as the Iron Range. She grew up there and decided that she wanted to become a nurse. She came to the Rochester area and trained at one of the hospitals here where there were a few physicians that had military backgrounds. And as Ruth says, she had adventure in her soul. And so she wanted to see more of the world. And I think her interest was piqued by the international patients that came to the Mayo Clinic and she was part of caring for. These military physicians suggested that she join the Navy Nurse Corps, which she did in 1936. And in 1940, she was assigned to the U.S. Naval Hospital, Pearl Harbor. And at first, that experience was really pretty positive. It was being in Hawaii was nice. Most of the servicemen were very healthy, so the workload wasn't very hard. She enjoyed things like a regular supply of iced tea and pineapple and had opportunities to go dancing under the starlit skies at the Royal Hawaiian Hotel in Waikiki. However, it was the assignment was good until that day, until December 7th, 1941. A little bit more from her narrative. The first serviceman was brought into the unit, bleeding profusely from an abdominal gunshot wound. The medical team, shaking in fear, managed to start an IV on him. By 8:10, the USS Arizona was hit by an armor-piercing shell and began sinking, taking with it 1,100 lives. The USS Arizona was also, as it was sinking, the USS Nevada attempted to pull out of the channel when it was hit and went aground near the hospital. The men were ordered to dive off and swim to shore, but the thick oil on the water ignited, and they found themselves swimming through fire. Their tropical uniforms, t-shirts, and shorts provided little protection, and their exposed skin burned as they swam through the flames. They arrived on the shores badly injured. As the first patient, who had been bleeding badly, died, burn victims began streaming in. The hospital staff had to be innovative. In a storage unit, they found small hand pumps intended for spraying insecticide. They filled the pumps with tannic acid and sprayed the burned soldiers. They hoped the tannic acid, with its strong antibiotic impact, would reduce mortality rates. So these are the kinds of narratives that I've been able to find throughout all of World War II, and sort of pieced together here to sort of share with you a woman's perspective. As I continued to do a little bit of research on Ruth Erickson and her story, I contacted the Historical Society in Virginia, where a wonderful woman volunteer there, Wright-Peterson, helped me sort of learn more about her, but not only about her, but just the whole Iron Range. And I learned that over 300 women in the Iron Range in Minnesota joined the military, again, all branches and doing all kinds of things. Ruth was a nurse, but that area in particular is absolutely rich with their commitment and involvement in World War II. There were some other women involved very early in the war, even before it started. I want to mention Mary Welsh from Walker, Minnesota. And she went to high school in the Bemidji area. Mary wanted to be a journalist. So after school, she went to Chicago. And from Chicago, at the time she finished, the war was starting, and she was able to get on with a London newspaper. And here's a picture, I hope you can kind of see, of Mary. It's kind of hard to do. Okay, there. There's Mary watching some of the troops in England. And Mary left a lot of her papers, and she was at the Fall of Paris. She was at Dunkirk. And during this whole time, she was writing, and eventually she was writing for Time Life magazine, a very accomplished journalist. And along the way, she met another journalist named Ernest Hemingway. And they were, by the end of the war, shortly after the war, married. And I didn't know that Hemingway's fourth and last wife was from Walker, Minnesota, and that they met during World War II. I mentioned that the troops needed a lot of food. A lot of women, in addition, were doing a lot of work behind the scenes and working in meat packing plants. The troops ate a lot of Spam. And those of us in Minnesota know where Spam comes from, Hormel in Austin. Their plant was at certain points, over a third of the workforce was made up of women working in nearly every area, butchering, canning, you name it. In their peak year of 1944, they produced over 646 million pounds of meat. Women also were involved in ammunition plants. There was a huge one built within months in the New Brighton area, around 2,000 acres. And here are some of the women, if I can get any better at doing this, producing cartridges out of that New Brighton plant, 60% of that plant was made up of women. We mentioned Rosie the Riveters. One of the my favorite stories in the book was Carol Johnson from Cloquet. She learned to do welding at one of the Vo-Tech schools up there. And she also left a really nice first-person narrative. I'll quickly find it here. She was a very accomplished welder. And it was her job to sort of stitch two pieces of iron together. And as Carol worked her way along the pieces, she had to endure bright light, heat, smoke, sparks, and droplets of molten metal. Carol sang to herself while she welded to get the pattern just right. And when the weld was finished, she had to knock off the crusty surface with a dull axe and metal brush. Excuse me. Don't worry, it's allergies. All right. Anyway, although the welders wore protective gear, Carol developed scars around her wrists and collarbone, where small gaps in her clothes left some of her skin exposed. One of her shoelaces caught fire, and she could smell the burning fabric, but she didn't want to stop. By the time a fellow welder began frantically beating out the flames, 4 inches of Carol's jeans had burned off. After that, she switched to leather shoelaces. Sorry. Maybe we'll take a look. Do we have a... One thing maybe I'll do right here is Harper might be able to assist me. I want to see that in addition to doing work in factories and in the military and being overseas, there was a group here in Minnesota. I want to see if you can identify this clip. Harper, hit it. Anyone recognize this group?
He was a famous trumpet man from out Chicago way. He had a funky style that no one else could play. He was the top man at his craft. But then his number came up and he was promised a draft. He's in the army now, a glowing reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle.
Hey, somebody got it!
They made him blow a bugle part of the whole same. He really brought him down because...
The Andrews Sisters, absolutely. The Andrews Sisters were from Minnesota, 3 sisters that were amazingly popular in this big band, in this big band time. There's a picture of them we were able to get for the book. They were very involved in going to different USO facilities here and abroad, and really encouraging people to buy bonds to help fund the war. I mean, I knew the songs and everything, but I didn't realize how big they really were. By the time their careers wound down in the 1950s, they had recorded 113 singles, 75 million records, more than 1,800 songs, including 8 that hit number 1 on the charts, and 19 gold records. They really committed themselves, to the war effort. And I've got a funny story of them going into Italy and performing, and into Morocco as well. All right. Any questions coming in? All right. Another aspect of this is cooking. So rationing had to take place during the war, as we recall, and it wasn't toilet paper. The big issues then had to do with food, rubber, gasoline, some of the different metals. And another important woman from Minnesota, Betty Crocker. This is Betty Crocker's first cookbook. And here's what Betty Crocker looked like at this time. She issued this cookbook during the war to help people work within the rations. And we described this in the book a little bit. One of the recipes included is emergency steak. And I don't know, meat may become a little bit of an issue for us, so this may be helpful. And the recipe says to take 1 pound of ground beef or hamburger, half a cup of milk, 1 cup of Wheaties, a teaspoon of salt, a quarter teaspoon of pepper, a little bit of onion, and then you place this on a pan, pat it into a T-bone steak shape. So you're going to make it steak shape, like 1 inch thick, and then you broil it. And that would be your emergency steak. Well, Betty Crocker wasn't a woman herself, but she was General Mills, created by General Mills, but there was a marketing executive behind her, Marjorie Child Husted, who was just a phenomenal marketing genius kind of behind Betty Crocker during these really important war years. Oh, I should have mentioned too, looking at my notes, in addition to the Andrews sisters in Minnesota, also claims fame to Judy Garland. And Judy Garland also did a lot of work with the USO shows and doing a lot of US bonds.
We're getting questions.
Okay, we're getting questions.
Diane Sandberg would like to know who were women in the Manhattan Project.
Okay, Manhattan Project. Yes. Picture. There was one woman's narrative was a little bit of a mystery to us, was actually on the project and ended up suffering a little trauma from it and had to be hospitalized because of all of the secrecy. She was in one of the facilities here in the United States working with the great scientists and mathematicians. And then one of the other women was in Washington, D.C., and she was a communications person, and she was responsible for actually issuing the telegram that announced to the world that the atomic bomb had been dropped. So let me get to the right page here. Here's Catherine Filippi in her office in Washington, D.C., who was very aware of what was going on, working on it in the D.C. area, responsible for issuing that important telegram. And I can read just a little bit. The other woman's name was Frances Jacobs, who was a WAC in the Women's Army Corps. And she didn't even know what she was signing up for. They basically screened women, and she was told to pack her bags, and at midnight, a truck arrived from the base she was at and took her to Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And there they thought they were going to go overseas, but that's not what happened. They were put on another truck and taken to a train station and ended up in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And she describes just in a lot of detail then being inside a barbed wire fence area, inside one of the buildings. She met Dr. Oppenheimer and the other scientists. She was a mathematician. She worked with a lot of the numbers. But it did become very stressful, the pressure, the strain of getting up at the crack of dawn, living at very high altitudes, working under extreme tension all day, and then coming home just to wash, iron, shine shoes, straighten lockers, and drill. She did break down and was hospitalized. It was sort of interesting. When she was hospitalized, they sent somebody else to be hospitalized in the bed next to her to make sure she did not divulge any of the secrets that she might have picked up during her work.
So the next question is, anything in the book about women of color or Indigenous women in Minnesota during the war and their role?
Absolutely. There's a wonderful story in here of Prudence. I've got her on one of my cards here. Yeah, Prudence Burns, who came to Minnesota and to study. She was from Kansas. And she came to the University of Minnesota to study public health in 1942. The military was really trying to find a lot of nurses. And Eleanor Roosevelt had really been encouraging them to become more diverse. And so they asked Prudence to help recruit more African-American nurses like she, and she got so into it, she ended up recruiting herself. And she ended up at Hospital Station 268 in New Guinea. And she has a very interesting story to tell. Here's a little bit of a picture of her. Get my fingers out of the way. In that when they were doing blood transfusions, there was a lot of controversy about blood collection. This was mostly organized by the Red Cross. At first, they didn't accept blood from African Americans. Then eventually they did, but the blood was tight. So different than the blood types that we're familiar with today, there was A blood and then blood. And A blood was African American blood and was only to be administered to African Americans. However, when Prudence was in this her base hospital in New Guinea, a very injured white soldier, hemorrhaging badly, was brought into her. And she said, "I've only got type A blood." And he said he didn't care, he didn't want to die. And there was, you know, quite a bit came out of this about this blood controversy and some of the racism that existed at that time. Also got a story about a mother working in some of the stores down in downtown in the Twin Cities, and a little bit about how she was treated, some very well by some of the white people, but not as well by others. Also have a chapter in here, it's nearly a whole chapter, and this is the woman who joined the Coast Guard, was from White Earth. And she then ended up, after the war, joining sort of the State Department and being overseas. Story here quickly. But at the same time, she and her mother were really involved in growing a support system in Minneapolis for Native Americans, as many of them were coming into the Twin Cities areas from reservations. Why am I having trouble finding this? Natalie Peak Blanche, an Ojibwe woman from White Earth. She started out working at that munitions plant. It had different names, Twin Cities Ordnance Plant in 1943. But then she went on from that to join the Coast Guard and was down in New Orleans there for quite a while, and then ended up returning and working for General Mills. So she has a wonderful story as well.
Do you want to put sawdust in the bed stretching out?
Did they put sawdust in the bread to stretch it out? I don't know the answer to that question. It didn't come up, and I don't think I saw it in the Betty Crocker cookbook, but that's a good question.
Are any pilots spies?
Are there any pilots or spies?
Oh, yes. So we mentioned a little bit about the spies, and we talked to the pilot. So one of the pilots is on the front of the book, and this is Virginia Hope. Virginia is from the Winnebago area of Minnesota, and she's a phenomenal pilot. I want to read just a little bit of the description of what a great pilot she was. So the WASPs were women that became pilots through different ways. They had to test out, get commercial pilot's licenses. They were not allowed overseas, but they worked throughout bases in the United States, moving planes from location to location, or transporting troops from different areas around. They were absolutely excellent pilots, very inspirational people. And here I want to read the Virginia Hope, sort of toward the end of the war, the major wrote a letter of recommendation for her, saying that she possesses an excellent temperament, unusual pilot instinct, and her work in instrument flying has been exceptionally highly meritorious. This officer recommends Miss Hope for any position involving aircraft piloting. So at the end of the war, these women, a lot of them wanted to continue being pilots, and most of them were turned away. Like Betty Strophus from the Faribault area was told she could be a secretary or a stewardess. Virginia happened to get a job with a private company continuing to ferry planes. The military stopped doing it and privatized that. And unfortunately, she was killed shortly after the war in Omaha when a plane crashed. She was not the pilot of it. I also really appreciate the book designer's work on this. All of the photos I worked with are black and white, and she colorized this one. But those WASPs are really inspirational to me. And I continue to think every time I fly, when we used to fly, that all of the pilots continue to seem to be men, mostly white men. And when women proved themselves 75 years ago, it's just really curious to me why airlines haven't been able to hire more women. I do talk a little bit about the post-war time in the book. A lot of women were glad to return to more traditional roles. A lot of women wanted to continue. The women found independence financially. They enjoyed, some of them, just the adventure, the freedom, and the money. I guess that was another thing I should mention too. Among the motivations of the women that I found throughout the book, some of them were doing it for patriotic reasons. They wanted to help in the war. They had brothers, cousins, friends that were in the war, and they wanted to support in their own way. They also wanted this personal independence and adventure, and some of them did it for financial reasons, for the jobs. Again, remember, the war started as the Depression was still existent in some areas, like the Iron Range. Somebody asked about the spies. So the women were part of the the Office of Strategic Services, OSS, which evolved into the CIA. So several women from Minnesota were involved in various ways. One was an artist, and she created maps and other training materials as they trained agents. When that particular one, her name was Jean Taylor. She was from St. Paul. And another woman was Ellie Thury. And here's a picture of her from Pine City. There, got it. They were part of Detachment 404. Where they, in this particular group, was overseas in Kandy, Ceylon, or Sri Lanka, as we know it today. And they collected and disseminated 2,400 intelligence reports. They trained 215 local agents. They launched 125 operations in Japanese-held territory. They trained operatives. They disseminated information to counteract Radio Tokyo, which was broadcasting in Thailand. This artist designed maps, charts, and visual aids for agent survival in jungle environments. One woman, when some of these women were on their way over there, when this Jean Taylor, who was an artist, arrived, it was Christmas in Ceylon. If I can find a little bit here. She had quite the, they were having a party when she arrived. Yes, here it is. It was Christmas Eve, 1944. And another woman, Julia McWilliams, was in charge of the holiday celebration. And Jean observed that Julia swept down the broad stairway into the great open lobby of the Queen's Hotel, waving and greeting everyone with her boisterous enthusiasm. Julia had used the last of her paperclip supply from Washington to decorate the registry with loops and swags hung from the rafters. And they had flowers and decorated profusely. Well, this Julia McWilliams would later marry someone that she met on this deployment, Paul Child, another OSS employee, and they moved to Paris, and she became Julia Child, the famous chef. So this group of Minnesota women were with Julia Child.
Do you have another question?
Sure.
How did you go about identifying women who served in the war from Minnesota?
How did I identify them? Yes. So, really good question. Again, I got this list of like 300 women from the Virginia Historical Society, and I just can't emphasize enough the importance of the not only the Minnesota Historical Society, which did a lot of oral history gathering of people. I relied on those oral narratives in the state historical society, but also county historical societies. So many of women turned their stories over, or historical societies went out and collected information, sometimes newspaper clippings, files of newspaper clippings. All of those things were extremely helpful to me. But like I said, it was just amazing. I would follow sort of the trail of one woman's story, and it would just lead to many, many more. One of the other spies, I know people get kind of interested in that. One of the other spies was went by the name Cynthia. And maybe you've heard of her before, and you didn't necessarily know she was from Minnesota. Her father was from Northfield, and her mother's family was from Morris. And she they eventually moved to Washington, D.C. And Betty spent a lot of time socializing, excuse me, with a lot of diplomats in that, and eventually started, shall we say, entertaining men, and got a lot of secrets that way. And one of them was extremely important to the United States. She was able to get the French codes that helped assure Operation Torch in North Africa was successful. Again, an important initiative of General Eisenhower's. Yes.
Were there any code breakers?
Yes, there were cryptographers.
Maybe repeat the question.
Oh, yes. Harper read the question for us, and it's, were there any code breakers? Yes. Excuse me. There were cryptographers. One of them in particular that I followed was in the Pacific, working on some very important codes that were important for winning the Pacific theater area with Japan. And they were able to prevent some very important sort of attacks, because they were able to get those codes. I can't remember if I mentioned, I've included a couple of immigrant women as well, as we think of our definition of a woman from Minnesota. one woman, Gisela Piper Kanapka, was a Jewish German woman whose story, she was very involved in the German resistance. And I learned a lot about how everyday people can communicate and be a very important part of overturning a government like Hitler's. Because of this, she ended up in concentration camps a couple of times. And I'd say that was, there were a number of parts of the book that were quite grim, if you will. I went into this thinking, oh, this is going to be a lot of celebrations and positive stories. But there were at least three times that the story got really grim, and Gisela's is one of it. Her story, though, of persevering, how she got through, how she endured being in those concentration camps is absolutely aspirational. Because I know there are some younger people listening, I'm not going to read those sections, but Gisela eventually was able to get out of Germany and into other parts of Europe and eventually to the United States, and became a very well-respected adolescent development psychology faculty member at the University of Minnesota. Another woman, French, who was a part of the French resistance and became an interpreter for the United States Army, and then married a soldier, and she came to Austin, Minnesota, Hormel. Her husband was a chef with a Hormel family.
We have another question here.
Mm-hmm.
Can you speak to the differences in experiences of women in rural versus urban areas of the state? Was there noticeable migration, and if so, any impacts on that? Any impacts of that on a small town in Minnesota?
Yeah, there were definitely women that left the rural areas and went into some of these larger plants where we were building planes and gliders. And like I mentioned, again, the auto industry is produce cars, started producing planes, but they produced sort of generic planes, and then some of those planes were brought to Minnesota to be customized and made into, given added radar capabilities and things like that. And it was a lot of women that were doing that work as well, as, including sheet metal kinds of things. And so women were coming into the city and doing some of that. A lot of women, though, did some very important work and stayed in their rural areas, helping with the blackouts, helping with some of the farming. One woman, her husband had passed away. Her sons were being drafted, and so she was left to run the farm. And just a wonderful story of her continuing to run that farm. Another woman took over the Selective Service Board in her town and was very involved in making sure that that was done appropriately and justly. At one point, she thought about leaving too, but was encouraged to stay. One of the women, going a little bit, that was in, as we're talking about those planes, making planes, was a woman named Fern Chambers. And she was doing some of that riveting work on the gliders. Some wood planes that were created and built in Minnesota that were then taken into areas and sort of towed by other planes, and then they would glide in so they could very quietly enter areas in Europe in particular. Anyway, I'm not sure how successful all of that was, but not because the planes weren't built well. The women were building the planes in Minnesota. Fern was building them. She worked with another woman, a team member, and that woman got another job and was replaced by a man who, I think because of an eardrum problem, wasn't eligible to be drafted. And she trained that man how to do the riveting. And when payday came around, she found out that he was being paid more than she was, and she just trained him. He didn't see a problem with this. He was a man, and he had a wife to support. Well, Fern didn't like it at all. The man said, hey, if you don't like it, why don't you just go join the army? And she said, if I'm going to join anything, I'm going to become a Lady Marine. And she did. She left work, went to the recruiting office, and became a Lady Marine. And At first thought she was going to use her riveting skills, but she ended up on a base in California that was staffed by 400 women who were doing all kinds of things, driving trucks, being bookkeepers. I mean, they were just really the infrastructure supporting that whole base. And Fern got assigned to charge batteries. Fern had never charged a battery before in her life, but these big airplane batteries for this marine aviation base. So they taught her how to do it. That was no problem. The problem was that those batteries would leak acid onto like her boots and into her clothing. A few weeks, because they didn't want a woman wandering around the base with holes in her uniform, they kept issuing her new uniforms. But that meant she had to keep sewing on the stripes and all of the insignia. And she got tired of doing that every time. So she took her fingernail polish and she painted the stripes onto her uniform, which really made for a sight with the pilots coming in with their batteries to be charged and finding first a woman there, which was a bit of a surprise to begin with, but then a woman whose stripes were painted on with fingernail polish. This is a little unusual. I guess we have another question.
Did you talk to any family members?
Yes, I had the opportunity, really a privilege, to actually talk with a few of World War II veterans themselves. A woman named Rose, a nurse from the Iron Range area, who was on some of the ships that took troops over and back into Europe. And it was really something to hear her, her stories are in the book, but to hear her tell me firsthand about what that was like, to hear the stories of the men, especially injured men coming back, some of the physical damage and some of the psychological damage that they endured. I also met with a woman named Helen, who was one of those people working on some of the intelligence in Washington, D.C. And I end the book with a story by a Japanese woman, Anna Tanaka, who she and her sister were born in Minnesota, a Japanese mother and a Japanese father, I'm sorry, and a German mother. And the mother left the family, and it was the Depression, toward the end of the Depression. The girls were really little. So the father sent the girls back to Japan to grow up with relatives there. So here are two sort of Minnesotan women in Japan in the Hiroshima area. And they grew up there as the war broke out. Anna was able to tell me stories about they converted their schools to factories. And students were young children expected to go to the factories and make different parts for planes and things like that. She described what that was like. She described the discrimination that they experienced being of mixed race in Japan as well. But what she really described to me, maybe I'll read, we've got a couple minutes.
We have one more question.
A little bit of her narrative, because she was in the Hiroshima area when on August 6, 1945, Anna Tanaka and her aunt were walking to the train station in Kiri, 12 miles west of Hiroshima City. They intended to buy train tickets for a visit to the countryside where other family members were living and growing food. At 8 o'clock that morning, Anna looked up in the direction of Hiroshima City and saw a big sun flash followed by a mushroom cloud. At first, Anna and her sister thought the poison gas had been dropped from American planes. The next day, they got a ride into Hiroshima with a cousin who had a truck for his restaurant business. They wanted to check on Anna's older sister, a student at the Red Cross Hospital. It was only allowed to the edge of the city, and they had to walk the rest of the way. Amid the chaos of incoming patients, Anna and her aunt were relieved to find the young nurse safe, but she was too busy to talk with them. Anna and her aunt walked past many rooms with people packed like a can of sardines, dead. Many were badly burned and suffering. And again, I'm not going to go on to read all of that, but she was there. She experienced subsequent flyovers of B-29 bombers. And then after the war, she and her sister returned to Minnesota, and she's here today. So an amazing story. One more quick question.
Are any of these women still alive, and
they still have Yes, okay, so that question probably came in. I think I mentioned I met Rose, and I met Helen. I met another one, Bernice Peterson's family. Bernice was a WAC and married to an Army soldier who was captured in Tunisia and ended up dying at Stalag 3. So yes, I did. And what, how grateful and what an honor it was to meet those women. So if you want to, continue sending the stories in, I'm going to wrap up here with a few other thoughts. And Harper wants to remind you that if you are, looking around for a Mother's Day present, especially since kids aren't in school and can't make Mother's Day presents anymore, this book might make a great Mother's Day present. And hold on here, my little cards. I had to go to paper cards. I can only take like so many screens at one time, and since I spend a lot of my day on Zoom, like I know a lot of other people do, basically want to thank you for listening to these stories tonight. It's been a wonderful opportunity to engage with you this way. I hope sometime we can connect more personally. But I also want to encourage you, like I mentioned at the beginning, what we're living right now is an important history. And I'd like you to consider submitting your stories, writing your stories, journaling what you are experiencing right now, toilet paper shortage and all of it, and submitting it to your county historical society or the state society. They have a project going on right now called History Is Now. And I think we're going to post the link to that. And, oh, Sam, I see one of those questions here. Sammy, that question came from you. Thank you. So Sammy, you and others, please plan on submitting your experiences to History Is Now. So people who are trying to do research 100 years from now, imagine, and they're wondering, what was that pandemic in 2020 really like? We can leave a good record, a record for them. Oral interviews. A coworker of mine, Aaron, has warned me that as intense as this feels, when it's over, it's going to be a while, but when it's over, it's all going to seem like a dream. And so we really want to capture it now. So again, thank you for listening to my stories. Please plan on sharing your stories. And oh, there we go. Thank you so much.